And so, if it's okay with you, we leave those with
you. Sure. Oh, you probably won't like me because I love technology, but I love appropriate technology. And I think a lot of the technology we've taken on is just, it's almost as if everything everyone invents, we're almost ordered, not ordered, but made to take it on. Otherwise, we can't function in the modern world.
Yeah.
So I've chosen to be definitely not anti-technology, but very much choosing what technology will make my life better, which doesn't mean easier. People seem to not know the difference.
Yeah.
So I keep saying to people who get onto this subject, I have my mountain bike, my piano, my pencil, my pen, my landline phone, I have electricity, I have all sorts of modern things that make my life good. But I haven't got a computer and I actually don't want one. And we live out of cell phone range, thank heavens.
Yes.
I've just been into Christchurch City.
Yes.
And I see this every time I go in. About 90% of the people are looking like
this,
doing nothing else but looking like this.
Yes.
They're not looking around them or talking to people or anything. I think it's a disaster.
We totally agree.
So websites, they're great, and we've got a website for Hinewei, but I don't have anything to do with it.
Yes.
Well, I feed information to the people who are working for us. Hinewei involved people.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have email, of course, because I haven't got a computer. And I love keeping the posts going.
Just yes.
Plain old music.
I actually write postcards myself.
Good. but also, it makes life very difficult. Banks, for example, they're not posting things out anymore. More of them have closed their branches. My closest branch is 7 hours bike ride away. Closest local branch of any bank. So I actually hate what's happened in the modern world. I don't want to be judgmental about it, because everyone has different needs. But I just find it a pity that many of us who choose to live a much, much simpler lifestyle, and it's not simple compared with people I've lived with in other countries, like the Kayans of Borneo, and what Maori used to live here, all that sort of thing. But it makes it very difficult to live in this modern society that I really love. I love New Zealand, and I love the people here, but life's becoming almost impossible for people who choose to live more simply. Yeah. Does that make sense?
Or totally.
I sound like a fanatic, I know what I'm
talking about. Well, wait till you hear what I say. No, we've got this thing which we've realized that people who just are staring at their phones, they lose the skills for learning, actually living on planet Earth.
They do.
And so, but they don't even know that.
No.
What they do feel is a fear, and it's the fear of losing technology. So back in the 1960s, when all this new technology started coming in with fax machines and stuff, then people started getting a fear of technology called technophobia. So we had to invent a new word called technopenuria phobia, which is the fear of losing technology. So people have this big fear of losing their technology. You know, the elevator stops in the middle of the building, the car stops in the back forest, you know, they don't get Wi-Fi connection, and this fear comes up and they don't even know what to do with it. So we do technopenuria healing processes.
What if I make you?
Coffee? Tea
is
great.
Tea is wonderful.
Just ordinary.
Tea.
And with milk?
I would.
Yes.
Milk,
yes.
Sugar?
Well, wait. Does the milk mean you have to drive 17 kilometers on your bicycle?
No. Because I'm a hypocrite. And whenever my family visit me, they ask what I need.
Oh, great.
Oh.
So there's no worries. And I buy and drop it all once.
I don't think that's hypocrisy. I think that's really clever. Collaboration.
I mean, collaboration is really more like how nature works. Really, so that's why we came here.
Mm-hmm. Actually,
and no sugar, kind sugar.
And I've changed my mind about the milk.
Oh, have you? Oh, there's plenty of milk.
Yes.
Oh, no, it's not a problem.
Okay. All right.
I've got powdered milk anyway.
Okay.
As a backup. So
yeah, no sugar, just a little milk. Yeah.
No way. But no sugar.
No sugar.
No. Okay. The same for both. Milk.
Yeah.
Yeah, yes. That's why we get along.
Yeah. No sugar. No lemon.
No lemon.
Yeah.
So, Chloe, where were you born, though?
I was born in Paris.
In Paris?
I was born next to Paris. But my dad was in the, or, yeah, was in the military, so we moved around a lot. Wow. And I lived in New Caledonia for a couple of years.
Closest neighbor?
Yes, neighbor from here. And I used to come here a lot because my grandparents were still in Wellington.
Yeah.
And so, yeah.
So it's your mum that's Kiwi?
Yeah, she is. And then
what's
she,
your dad? Like
French, yeah. And she moved to France for 25 years while we were growing up and moved around with us and then came back here. When we were
around. And so you're living here now?
No, so just for the 3 months.
Just for the three months.
Yeah. And,
wow. So you were brought up in a bilingual household?
Yeah, bicultural. Yeah, it was really fantastic.
I would love to be fluent in two languages or more.
But we met, Clinton and I met at this project in Spain close to Murcia, which is not quite Granada. Granada is in the south, and it's kind of in the center of Spain where nobody is, and the desert of the Sahara is just creeping on Europe completely, and so it's completely dry.
Yeah.
And there was this man called John Dennis Liu.
Yeah.
Do you know him?
No.
So, and he's half Chinese, half American, and was a journalist who was sent to China on this project of land restoration, where they restored, it was immense.
Yeah.
It was like thousands and thousands of hectares. And it went from this desert where China had mined the land to this green, and his movie was called Green Gold. And then from that point, which he was pretty young when he did that, he totally got awakened to the devastation on Earth and spent his whole life and still doing it about trying to talk to government and corporation about restoring land.
Yep.
And noticed after, really, it was, so there's one here.
I'll just get another one.
Okay.
Is that, where, is that strong enough? Oh, no, here. Oh, yeah. Sorry, here.
Oh.
Is that strong enough?
Oh, yes, that's perfect. And and after 20 years somehow, 25 years of trying to talk to government and corporation, realized that the purposes would not match. The corporation did not want to make land restoration as their priority.
Yep.
And so finally realized, okay, the people can do this. Because the people, the local people who care about the land will do this. They just are missing some kind of framework. Resources and framework and places.
Yep.
And so we were actually in the first, he called that ecosystem restoration camp. And the idea was we make a camp, we restore it. So we plant enough trees, basically mostly that. And then we move on to the next piece of land and the next piece of land. And hopefully if there's enough camp and enough movement, that would be the restoration of on Earth. And
so that was 5.5 years ago.
Yeah.
And the project's still good, still growing. And they fired us, though.
Yeah. Why did they fire you? Clash of opinions?
Something like that. We wanted to include that we realized that the land restoration wasn't really sustainable if there wasn't a human restoration happening at the same time. Oh, yeah. And that really, it scared people to realize, okay, maybe we need to learn something new. And people thought, oh, I'm just going to be here and plant trees and not change. And that, so that was a different purpose that was happening.
The different approach here, you're probably aware of this, but in effect, a scientist, a new scientist, said it very well. He said the answer is not to plant trees, but to just retire enough land and manage it softly to let nature just regenerate the forests of the world. And I mean, it's not every situation is different, but that's how we started out here. We've got everything going for us. We've got reasonable rainfall, good soils, seed sources, which everyone underestimates completely, but seeds is just not a limiting factor anywhere on Banks Peninsula, even though we've taken more than 99% of the native forest off. Nature's just itching to put it back and has been doing it. And just taking away some of the deleterious things that are slowing that down, here it just sped it up just unbelievably. So that within 35 years, it's gone from basically totally uneconomic, totally unpastoral, weed-infested, marginal farmland to strongly regenerating native forests with all largely native canopy now. So that's our whole philosophy is minimum interference, no planting at all of any significance. We love planting trees too.
Mm-hmm.
I love it, but only around the houses and the visitor centre.
What did you mean that there was totally unestimated of the seed supply?
Well, you see, people come here and they say, have you planted all this? And I say, look, we just totally overestimate our own importance in the regeneration of native forest and totally underestimate how unbelievably efficient and hugely productive nature is. So when I say the seed source is not limiting, even the rarest of the rare things here, plants that are just on the verge of local extinction because they've been so, the habitat's just been so wiped. Just take away those deleterious things as much as possible. You never get rid of all of them. And they come back, they just bounce back. And so I sort of use the story of one of the most common colonizing native woody plants here is a tree we call Kanuko. It's in the myrtle family. It's all over the place, it's really abundant. And it acts like the exotic gorse, it just recolonizes pasture and bare land. On the big slips we had in our big store over a year ago, there's just trillions of Kanuko seedlings. Trillions, and I mean trillions. I mean, that's off the top of my head, but how could you plant a trillion Kanuko trees? You can't, but nature's doing it without any cost to us. Nothing. Just does it. So I always say that one Kanuko tree produces enough seed in 1 year, if they all germinated, which of course they mostly do, but they don't. They're competing. Mm-hmm. Some are dying because of drought and the wrong positions and everything. But nature would have enough, if all of them germinated, that would be enough Kanuko trees to cover this entire land we look after in Kanuko trees.
Which is 1,500 hectares,
yeah,
right?
It is.
Wow.
So the notion that we can do better by collecting the seed, propagating it, growing it on, planting it, protecting it from the animals that eat it, it sounds right, but it's just completely naive nonsense to me, it is. Yeah. But at the same time, every situation is different. I'm involved with, in fact, did you talk to him, Ash or Max?
Max,
because Ash is up there too, and he's in the wintertime, he's involved in another project called Te Ara Kākariki, which means the green pathway. And they're planting native plants across the plains, which is a long way from native seed sources. That the Canterbury Plains have just been hugely transformed from what they were. So I'm not poo-pooing planting, but I'm just saying I wish people would just realise how naive and simple we are thinking that we can do it better than nature over most of the world.
And what was there before? You were about to say what the plains were like before.
The plains were very interesting because people have only been here for less than 1,000 years.
Yeah, altogether, yes.
Before Polynesian settlement, the plains are very interesting because of our mountains off to the west, and they're eroding. They're very young mountains, they're eroding hugely. So the whole plains are just sort of coalescing shingle fans built out across the continental shelf, we like to call it. It's just bedrocks down there, but it's deep in shingles and sediments. And because the rivers kept changing all the time, there was all sorts of rejuvenated habitats all the time. But given long enough, across the plains, forest developed, of course, and there's a remnant in the middle of Christchurch still. Rickerton Bush, it's worth going to see. That's
okay.
It's right in the heart of Christchurch, and here's a stand of old growth kakatea forest. So it was a mosaic of younger and older soils supporting different plant associations from forest to just open grassland, which would have gone to forest if nature had left it undisturbed for long enough. But then when the Polynesians arrived, and then later the my ancestors arrived, they just cleared forest, both waves of human settlement.
Wow.
The Banks Peninsula was forested from side to side and from top to bottom. And then, I would have loved to see it. But then the Maoris cleared about, over hundreds of years, but they cleared about a quarter of it, a quarter to a third of it. And then all sorts of native grasses and bracken fern and stuff colonized it. And all the time nature was regenerating the forest. But once people are here, the fire frequency here just goes up immensely. And so, sorry about this. I just realized there's a gaping hole in my
the forest what goes away? The forest. As soon as people get here, the forest.
The fire frequency.
Oh, fire frequency.
Goes up. Yeah.
Yes.
Oh, okay. Yes. So the forest has been trying to regenerate all the time, but with frequent fires, it's inhibited and slowed down.
Sure.
Yeah.
So the plains are very interesting, but there's very little native vegetation left on the plains.
Yeah. We just drove from Kaikoura down.
It's the east and south island there. But Banks Peninsula is sticking out into the sea here, all volcanic hill country.
Mm-hmm.
We've virtually lost no native plants. In terms of area, we've lost almost all the forest, old growth forest. Mm-hmm. Here's the figures. There's less than 1% of old growth forest left, but there's about 20% of forest, native forest now. And that means most of it's just regenerated forest against all odds, because the farmers don't like it regenerating because it takes over their pasture and their livelihoods. Even though it's a marginal hill country, it's not very productive pastoral farming.
Does the government provide, what's it called?
Subsidies.
Does the government subsidize
agriculture?
Yes.
Well, the subsidies were basically taken off in the 1980s. It was a huge move by a Labour government, and the farmers hated it, but it was amazingly successful. And so New Zealand agriculture is very lightly subsidised.
Mm.
Compared with Europe, the subsidies in the EU, for example, it's just like another planet.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, the farmers in Spain are paid to plow and not plant anything, killing off anything that might possibly grow.
Yes, well, you see, the trend here should be that all this country that shouldn't really ever have been cleared and farmed, but more and more it's going into native forest by default. And they keep trying to clear it. And even around me, they're spraying Karnica, that colonising woody plant, because it's invading their pastures, and they want pasture. But if they, and I think they're beginning to see this, if they took away trying to do that to at least to their poorer, in pastoral terms, country, they can claim carbon credits from that, and they could earn three times as much per hectare from carbon credits as they could ever do from pastoral farming. And they're beginning to click to that now. But the opposite to that is that there's a huge push by forestry companies and even by some Māori iwi, because of the unemployment situations, they want to plant exotic pine forests, not for harvest, not for timber, but to sequester carbon. It's just such an absurd nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
It's again, like, I think the biodiversity problem is just about as big as the global warming problem. And they interlocked, completely interlocked. It's like one problem. And so to plant exotic pine trees, Pinus radiata is one of our worst weeds here in terms of what we're doing. And yet they want to plant thousands and thousands and thousands of hectares, not to harvest ever, just to have a temporary, but what they call permanent forest. They grow fast. Their carbon curve goes up at about 25 years and then starts to fall because they're aspiring more than they're fixing, more than they're... photosynthesizing.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the native forest curve, it just climbs more slowly in the first 20 years, but up and up and up and up.
Mm-hmm.
100 years later, it's still climbing.
Oh, wow.
And then we've got all those biodiversity values as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it makes no sense to me. We're fighting and fighting that. Mm.
Well, what do you mean by we? We're fighting.
Why we? With our trust, for example, but a sort of an elusive amalgamation of people who are concerned about this. There's a wonderful woman scientist called Dame Anne Salmond. I don't know if you've ever heard that name, but she was New Zealander of the Year every now and again. They select the New Zealander of the Year every year. She was New Zealander of the Year a while back. She speaks fluent Te Reo Māori. She's very involved in Indigenous issues and things, but she's a scientist and an anthropologist. But she's also just really sees so clearly what all this pine nonsense is about. So she writing lots and lots of articles and pushing. She's been here with her husband. Yeah.
Mm. Mm. I was going to kind of change.
Good.
Yeah. Well, so I had this, the question was about your beginning.
Oh, the beginning, that's right.
Yes.
And see, I talked to that. I haven't gone to the beginning yet.
Because a lot of people that we talk to are at the beginning.
Yeah.
And that's where we really are in contact with people. And then when they fly, you know, we basically don't see them anymore when they are doing their thing. Yeah. So
it's interesting, just as an aside, people who are at the beginning, they now come and see me quite often.
And there's just very recently a couple, very nice young Kiwi couple turned up, and they were looking for land on Banks Peninsula. They live in West Auckland at the moment. Mm. They want to shift down to the South Island, and what they really want is a bit of land to do exactly what you say, just to do this, really, mm-hmm. on any sort of scale. So more and more that's happening. And because I'm here, I keep my ears on what, or my eyes or my ears on what land is for sale and everything.
Great.
So that is happening a lot, yeah. But how we started is interesting because I'm a botanist by profession. Okay. And I was doing a big field study of the whole of Banks Peninsula, just the vegetation and biological survey of the whole of Banks Peninsula. And I brought up next to Banks Peninsula. Christchurch is basically where I came from, Timaru for the beginning. But So I knew, thought I knew Banks Peninsula so well, and I thought that really the native biodiversity had been so hammered, it had sort of retreated into corners and everything else was exotic, large exotic pasture. But after I'd been about 2 years into the fieldwork with Banks Peninsula, I realised that we've lost so few plant species. They're still here, even though some of them are just hanging on. And given the slightest chance, bounce back, they come bouncing back with vigour and resilience that we can only dream about, really, about trying to ourselves. But I'd never ever had enough money to do it on my own. I just wasn't interested in earning money. I just liked doing work I thought was enjoyable and useful. And basically, if you earned enough money to live, that was fine, except you never get enough money to buy land.
Yeah.
And I have to say, the whole notion of owning land is just completely ridiculous.
Mm-hmm.
Owning land, how absurd can you get? And that was one of the big clashes between Pākehā and Māori, you know, in the 19th century. The Māori had no notion of actually owning land. It was just, it wasn't even in their world views.
Mm-hmm.
And so when Pākehā people came and said, we'd like to buy this land off you, they didn't realise they were actually selling the land. That was just absurd. They thought they were selling sort of rights to use it for a bit.
Mm.
So that caused a lot of problems. Big problems, really, in the beginning. In the beginning of the two clashes between the two. Well, I shouldn't say clashes, because it wasn't all clashes. It was amazing, the history here, really, how those two different ways of people meshed. And it was intermarriage from the very beginning. But all the same, land does cost money in terms of our Western view of it. And I would never have had enough money to do it on my own. But that was when I was introduced to a Christchurch businessman who wasn't that wealthy, but he had set up a fund to purchase land on Banks Peninsula. Yeah, that's how it all happened. We just got together. He said, could you keep your eye open for a bit of land that my trust can buy that would be what we want to do with it? Just basically, he wanted to create a sort of sanctuary for all the native bird life that was still here.
Wow.
Hmm.
And he had actually quite naive views about ecology, really. He, at one stage, he said, after we'd been going for a wee while, he said, and I'm not criticising, this was interesting because I learned a lot off him too. I knew nothing about money and investments. He did, he was really good at it. And he said, Hugh, I'm not quite sure what all this emphasis on plants is. I had in mind a sanctuary for our native birds. And I said, well, habitat is everything. And so he got that, he got it straight away. So that was quite a learning curve for both of us. He was totally different, he was quite conservative. And hinting on racist in a way, the way people, some people are just, probably we all are, just slightly racist because we can't quite understand what, I don't know why, what someone with different coloured eyes or something is. but he learned a lot, and he's died at 96, about 5-6 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I think he'd be 100 now. Mm. Yeah. So that was how it was possible. That's how we began. And he said, are you interested in the project as well as looking for land? And I think I waited half a nanosecond, and I said, yes. And I've never had any regrets. There's been major hassles along the way, but never any regrets. It's been a fantastic project from the very beginning. Yeah.
So those hassles along the way, people will face those. And so if you could tell some stories about some of the hassles and how you made it through, then that would be very helpful.
Well, the first hassle was... we were trying to set up within a farming community something that they just didn't understand. I mean, the notion of leaving this exotic gorse alone, which to them was the worst weed of pastoral farming they could possibly think of. And not only did they find it impossible, all the law was against it too. We were required by law, one, to keep gorse away from our boundaries with farmland, and that was fair enough, and we did that diligently and as environmentally friendly way as we could. But we had to use herbicides. It was just impossible otherwise. But they also wanted us, anything that was even remotely like pasture, even if it had a few scattered gorse bushes, we had to take them out, according to law. And I said, I'm not going to. So that we had fought those for 25 years, quarter of a century we were fighting that.
How did you know not to?
Well, every ecologist would know not to, I think. I mean, gorse is just a colonizing, short-lived, totally light-dependent, rapidly growing plant that just takes advantage of disturbance. Well, definitely in New Zealand ecology. It comes from Europe and Britain. And it behaves slightly differently. There, well, it's got all sorts of things that feed on it and eat it and limit it and slow it down. But here, it just loves the whole environment here. And it grows in a slightly wider range of habitats. It just doesn't only grow on poor heathland soils. It grows on even these soils are relatively fertile in the New Zealand context. And it just grows more strongly. It fixes nitrogen, so it's never any shortage of nitrogen for it. But then as soon as the native plants grow through, the numerous native plants love its shade, love its shelter. They even take advantage of the increased above the natural native levels of nitrogen in the soil. And so if you can keep them being eaten by the animals, the native just come through. And as soon as they come out the top and shade it, the gorse is dead. Mm. As soon as you shade it, it's dead.
Mm.
So every ecologist knows that it's just a pioneering, short-lived plant. And everything that the farmers were throwing at it, they can keep good, like, flat land on the plains. They can control gorse there. It's relatively easy. But here, where it's entrenched in the landscape, everything they do makes it worse. And so their reaction is not to think, well, what are we doing wrong? They think we're not working hard enough.
Mm.
And some of them keep trying rid of it, and then give up because it's just impossible. Mm-hmm. So they walk off the land, or they sell the land to some other unsuspecting, naive person. That's what happened just across from the next valley. This guy, it was in the video, you might remember it, but this guy, when we first set up here, we spelled out what we were going to do in the local newspaper and in interviews and things, and we said we were going to leave the gorse alone to act as a nurse canopy for native regeneration, which would obliterate it. And this guy across from the next valley, who lives in a totally gorse-infested farm, he said, he wrote a letter to our local newspaper, only comes out every 2 weeks. And he wrote a letter back saying how stupid this was. He said, he actually said if it'll take at least 100 years for the gorse to open up enough for any native to come through. And then he said another 100 years before it does come through, and if at all, he said. And then he said in that time that you could get 8 rotations of Pinus radiata to the timber crop and add something, he said, to the local community. And then that's when he called us a fool and a dreamer. That's when the title comes from. Well, 3 years later, he came back and knocked on my door. I got to know him reasonably well. And he said, Hugh, I just wanted to apologise for calling you a fool and a dreamer. And I said, no, it's a compliment, come in. So he came in and discussed it all. And he was basically coming to tell me that he was fed up with trying to fight the gorse, and he was selling up and leaving, which he did. And that farm is still a gorse-infested, uneconomic, unproductive farm, neither conservation nor agriculture. It's just sort of in a hopeless halfway state, and it's being maintained because the new owner keeps trying to fight the gorse. And the contrast with here is just mind-blowing.
Mm.
And the good thing is that every farmer around us there, even the most sceptical, after only 35 years, it's quite a time, I suppose, but none of them are against us now, after those initial battles. Yeah. So that's been really good.
But the 25 years of those court, those trials or court, you were saying for 25 years you're trying to battle against this law.
Battle against the law as well.
And so you went to court and you were...
Well, we didn't. We were never actually taken to court, but they can serve a notice on you they can do draconian things. For example, they can say your boundary's not 10 metres back for the fair boundary fence, and if you don't do it by such and such a date, in other words, spray it, and then you just actually limit it for a little while, that comes back with greater, bigger than before. So we have our own manual methods, using herbicide, but very carefully, just stump poisoning. And we were working away steadily at all our boundaries doing that, and the progress was terrific, but it was slower than they wanted to see. Mm. They want instant results, that's what people tend to want. Mm. So they serve a notice on it, say if you don't do it within 2 months, we can bring a helicopter along, spray the boundary right along, kill all the natives that are coming up. And this has happened in parts of the zoo. It never happened to us because they began to get a bit nervous about us because we did put out quite a lot of very sensible, I may say, explanation about what we were doing. And with a greater and greater support base, I think they would have been quite scared to take us to court. They would have been made to look absolute idiots.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
And they didn't. And so now that whole thing has completely changed. We've got new noxious plants officers. They're all very friendly and cooperative, and it's amazingly different.
The support base was people who had become aware of of your procedure.
Yeah, and it just grew very, very slowly. So the amazing thing is that now donations and carbon credits are our biggest sources, two separate sources of income for our trust. For the first 10 years, everyone who was here worked for nothing because we were earning enough money to live on from other jobs, like I was a freelance botanist. It got more and more difficult because there was so much work here.
Mm.
But we managed fine. And now we pay everyone who works here, we pay a wage, a salary. And it's only possible because the donations are unbelievable. To me, they are. Mm.
Great.
Mm.
Yeah. I want to go back to her original topic, but first I just wanted to say one of the reasons we're doing this project is so that people can upgrade their thoughtware. We call it thoughtware, like you said, awareness or the worldview.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's to what they're using to think with. And it's so, coming here to view the contrast between obviously this destroyed ecologies out there and this property is so huge. So, and then people can walk around here.
Yes, I don't have to ask you. It's entirely open to the public.
Yes.
That's been really good too.
Okay.
Because people do come and realize.
Yes.
What's working.
Yeah. And so the question was, is there anything else that a visitor can do to study the project or work on the project or help out as a volunteer or anything?
Well, that's a very interesting question because I hate sounding negative like this, but since the video came out, we've been overwhelmed with offers of help, which is so lovely. That's terrific, but it's totally impractical. And we do use volunteers, but very sparingly. We've just got a little team of 4 people who all know what they're doing. And I mean, I don't call myself a very good manager of people, but 4 I can handle. I don't know how people manage 100 workers. I've got no idea how they do it. But I would make things much more complicated if I even had to manage 2 volunteers every morning instead of 4 of us who know what we're doing, who are all attuned to it. They can work on their own without any problem. They don't have to be shown anymore. But a volunteer who we've used volunteers in the past, and 1 or 2 of them have been brilliant, and one is so good that we use them. He's not perfect though, but he comes once a week, and he's been enormously helpful and so obliging in his help and everything. Like I can't go and get bridge timber on my bike, even with a trailer. But he said, "No, I'm coming past Horrible Timber. I can pick it up." And he's just so obliging. It's fantastic. So some volunteers are just fantastic, and most are just good, but take a huge amount of organisation, organising and teaching and everything. And some think they know exactly what to do. We have our ways, but some of them may not be the best, but the ones we've worked out over decades, so we like people to stick to them in terms of weed control and everything. So we don't use volunteers much at all. And it does make it interesting because I find it a bit funny that people think conservation projects should work on volunteers, but, and this is going to sound awful, I'm not sure how it comes across, but, and I never say this to people, But if you were a lawyer, say, sitting in an office, and someone said to you, bring up and say, oh, so we're coming to help you for a week in the office, well, a lawyer wouldn't take it on. Possibly what they'd do is select a, what they call an intern or something, and specially arranged and interviewed so they know they're going to be good, all this sort of thing. But why do they think conservation, which is, to me is just as demanding and complicated as being a lawyer, to be honest. Mm. You've got to know what you're doing. And so I find that a bit hard to get my head around.
Mm. One of the idea of the book is that these projects, and we're also looking at eco-villages, I don't know if you know about eco-villages, mm-hmm. and whatever, these edge projects, we would call them, that have a different thought, where there's people who are looking for a different relationship to earth, a different relationship to themselves.
Yeah.
These projects are actually quite rare.
Yeah.
And so that's why some of these projects open their doors of saying, okay, let's pay the price of having volunteers, because what the possibility is that these people change and grow up but at the same time, I totally understand this thing where people think they kind of volunteer and somebody's going to take care of them, and that doesn't work for the project. It just brings the project down. And so we want to, in the book, the clarity is, if you're going to come, it's like you were saying, it's you're going to give more than you take, and that's also for the project to decide, you know, will that work really?
And I know there are conservation projects here in Canterbury, in this province, that do use volunteers heavily, and it seems to work.
Okay.
Yeah, like Quail Island or Tamahua in the middle of Littleton Harbour. That's a restoration project there, and that's a planting project. Okay. If I was looking after Otamahua, I wouldn't actually be planting, but I'm not preparing it. It's been wonderful in terms of education and involvement and everything. All those things are fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, I feel my best contribution can be just to run this corner of the earth as well as I can, and I can't change the whole world. I never pretend anyone could. Well, maybe one or two people could, like Gandhi and Christ or whatever.
he didn't
agree well. but no one can they? But what can change the world is what you're saying is education and views and sort of absorbing different attitudes and cultures. That can change the world, and that sort of grows organically from little nuclei like this to the other project. So I'd rather just look after this properly, and it's completely open to the public, so thousands of people come here every year, and they take away a little bit from it, I'm sure. So that's how I see my contribution to that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Not by having hundreds and hundreds of unskilled workers here helping.
Just a little idea. It sounds like you could use a volunteer who could organize volunteers.
Yeah, we could, but even so, that still doesn't appeal to me, because I feel the four of us, we never ever get everything finished, but we're doing it as efficiently as I can envisage, really. And so that's just adding another layer of complexity on. But and for another project, it could work beautifully, and people do. I know they do, so I'm not doing it. But for this project, that's how I see it.
So I want to go back to your question.
Go ahead.
Which is simply, there is a kind of motivation that you used to commit your life, in a way, to take care of this corner of the world. And can you just talk about that? Like, what was the sense you had, or the perspective that would allow you to do that?
Well, it's like a dream come true for me. There's nothing I'd rather be doing. Maybe I could make a bigger contribution to the world if I was, a lawyer or a writer or anything like this, but I don't know. But this is what I do best, and this is what I love the best. And it's not a sacrifice or a burden or anything. It's like a dream come true. Even to the extent that I remember from school days, early high school days, maybe I was 13, 14, 15, and I at that stage I hated mathematics. I just could not get my head around mathematics. I now fully understand what a miracle mathematics is, but I haven't got a mathematical brain, really. And so I spent all my math classes using my math books to design nature reserves. You know, at age 14, I was designing nature reserves. And every now and again, the teacher would come along and find I'd fill my math book with nature reserves, and I was appearing to be dense and dumb about mathematics, and I'd get caned. I mean, we got corporal punishment in those days. I got frequently caned for that sort of thing. It's bizarre now.
Well, talk about pain. You had to face this pain. Oh, that's bizarre.
So when the chance came to me, when Morris White, the guy who did Christchurch Business, who had set up a fund that made it financially possible to even start this, he wasn't that wealthy, and the fund wasn't that big, but it was the real the starter, the nucleus of what happened. It was just like, that's why I didn't hesitate to say yes, because I thought, right, here we are, I'm offered this path, so I'm going to choose it straight away. And as I said, never had any regrets.
I mean, I don't know if you have a sense of, you know, a lot of people we meet have been really wounded by school, you know, not just physically, but, you know, emotionally and psychologically, and where this seed of who they are, you know, like you were just drawing these nature reserves, get completely beaten out of them, you know, either physically or not.
Yeah.
And it's like, how do you have a sense of how did you keep that flame going?
Oh, well, I see, honey, my last report from my high school, which was in Christchurch, it said has done very well, but is somewhat prejudiced by claims of outside interests. That's, I think, those are the exact words. And that meant drawing nature reserves in my math book. But also, I was a mountaineer and a tramper and a skier for a while. Those are all my outside interests. So all those claims of outside interests are what I've used my whole life for. So that's how bizarre school can be.
Mm-hmm.
But I didn't actually, I didn't hate school. There's lots of things about school I quite like. And the things I hated about it, I just thought, oh, well, this is just something you've got to put up with. And then I'll be out of it soon. I can just be a free adult, basically.
Mm.
And that's how it happened. Mm. Gosh, I was very lucky. It's amazing how lucky I've been. Because when I left high school, there was suddenly this chance. It's what the Americans called Peace Corps volunteers.
Mm.
So the very year I left high school, we were setting up volunteer service abroad in New Zealand, which is about volunteers. I went as a volunteer. What a hypocrite I am. I went to Sarawak and Borneo.
Mm.
And that was such a mind-blowing year. I thought I'd just may or may not follow my siblings and go to university, and thought I might not. And then off I went to Sarawak for a whole year as an assistant volunteer teacher, getting a very small little wage, no more than most of the local people got. And it was mind-blowing. I just suddenly exposed to all these different cultures and indigenous cultures in Borneo and Chinese and Malay. And it was just amazing. So I came home from that year just, I wasn't transformed, but it just lit those fires, really.
Do you know the book Original Wisdom from Robert Wolf?
I've heard of it. I haven't read it, actually.
You might really like it. Obviously, you're a reader.
Yeah, well, I'm just reading a book a bit like that called Braiding Sweetgrass. And
yes.
Have you heard of that? Oh, yeah. Well, I thought that was going to be all sort of New Age and eerie fear and everything. But she's a scientist who happens to be an Indigenous American, Canadian.
Mm.
And I'm really loving that.
And he was the same. Robert Wolf was a scientist. Yeah, okay. And he went there as a scientist and was with the Sengoi people. I don't think it was Borneo, but it was on
Malaysia.
It was Malaysia.
Yeah, the part of Borneo I was in is part of Malaysia now. So it might have been the Bornean part, or it might have been Peninsula Malaysia. Maybe. Yeah.
I think he was on the main peninsula, the book is just incredible of him, the scientist, you know, now they don't call him Pakeha, but white men discovering these indigenous culture and then being transformed. Yeah. Yeah, he's incredible.
Yeah. Yeah.
This moment where you somehow started realizing that you had an opportunity to swim downstream instead of, you know, fighting against the structures and systems that were annihilating life on Earth, essentially. And you could actually instead be carried and go in the direction where Gaia of Earth would want you to go.
Yeah.
And then there, what happened that you had the freedom of movement as, like you said, free adult. You said the word free adult, I think, free adult man. You had this moment of realizing that you made it through school and that you did not give yourself up in terms of what you really longed for or were interested in. And then there, you were starting to be carried by this project. Like how was that?
Well, I mean, I've always felt as an outsider, to be honest, which is funny for me because I love New Zealand and I love New Zealanders, but I feel like an outsider and always have. But that, as well as being a bit anxious making, that also gives you an amazing freedom just to think, well, this is how I want things to be, and I will live as if I'm contributing to the way the world should be. Without thinking I can. You can just do in your own little corner what seems best. And that's the spark. That was what it was. Mm. So I always felt a bit different. And so I thought, well, I can be different. I don't have to go along with all this culture that I think is ridiculous. And as part of a culture that I love as well. So I think that's how it happened. Even like that, doing nature reserves in my book at 13 or 14, but long before that. Partly my parents are important, because my dad was actually a religious minister, can you believe?
Oh.
And I'm not religious. I get very annoyed with religion, but I didn't get annoyed with his religion. Well, it was Presbyterian, Protestant Presbyterianism, and my mum was almost even more religious than my dad. But they were so liberal and so tolerant and so unjudgmental about other people's religions, other people's non-religions. It was an extraordinary upbringing in many ways. But the other thing that they were loved, they were outside people. Dad loved fishing and Mum just absolutely loved tramping and took us into the mountains and they took us on family holidays. And at an incredibly young age, that just so sparked my love of nature. They took us to Stewart Island, the southernmost big island in New Zealand. And I'd never been there before. I think I was maybe 10 or something. That also, just like Borneo later, it just blew my mind. It's like have you been to Stewart Island? It's it's sort of like old New Zealand. It's largely covered in original vegetation, and there's kiwi there galore.
Mm.
The native parrots are there, kāko and kākari here. It's just, and it's a national park now. But it wasn't the national park then. But that, I just felt, oh, I just utterly love this. I just, passion's an overworked word, but it was like that. I just loved it with all my being. Yeah. The birds and the wilderness. And just about only had 400 people on it. And it's only got about 400 people now. It's a tiny little town. Mm.
So what would you say to people who were somehow knew that modern culture was not their home?
I meet quite a few people who think like that. So when I say I felt different, not now, well, I feel different from lots of people, but not, there's many, many people I relate to on that level. Yeah.
And
people who don't have a car or a computer, also, I do not know quite a few people like that.
And what, but many people are concerned, like they don't think they are earning enough money to live in modern culture. Like, what would you tell people?
Well, the thing is, if you don't own a car or a computer, and if you're happy with living a simple life, you're earning more than enough money. Anyone would. Well, I'm not saying anybody, but in New Zealand, probably. It's by far from being an egalitarian society. There's not that many people who are poor in a real sense. I mean, they are poor in New Zealand society because they see what everyone else has got. And so then, and there's envy, and they think they need them. Oh, I don't know, it's very hard to judge by other people, isn't it? But I think if you do have simple needs, you can live on almost nothing.
But there's some leap people have to make about this fear of being judged or fear of being weird or fear of being...
Oh, yeah.
And what could you say to them to to make the kind of leap that you did?
I don't know. I don't know what to say to them. But it's just meeting them, talking with people as freely as you can, I suppose, and not being judgmental and not saying that you have to do this or you need to do that. That's what religion does. We don't have, no one wants to do that, really. Yeah, I think so. Because, yeah, I mean, you could be like that and be a hermit, and then you wouldn't be no toing and froing of ideas like that. But maybe I am a grumpy old hermit, but... But I don't.
Well, people knock on your door, you still let them in, so...
Give them a cup of tea, have a conversation.
I think you just go on living life the way you think it should be lived. And people, without being lectured to, because I do feel I'm lecturing sometimes, but if you don't lecture and if you don't preach like a sermon or a pulpit, but people say, oh, he hasn't got a car or a computer or a cell phone, he seems quite happy. And then they sort of think to themselves, why is he happy? He doesn't have those things, he doesn't want them. He doesn't need them. And even when I say that making life more and more difficult, it's far from being impossible. Even though you can have to, almost everything you do, you have to do online now. But I don't do things online, and I just keep writing letters and putting stamps on the envelopes and posting them off, and they're still being delivered.
And what would you recommend people read or study to empower themselves to like that? Do you have favorite books?
Oh, I have lots of favorite books. I find, and all I do with that is just if I read a really good book, like I talk about braiding sweetgrass to people. The interesting thing is I didn't know about this book, and I was guiding a walk on our, once a year we have a walking, the whole Venice Prince has a walking festival, and we provide one or two walks, guided walks on Hinewei. And so it was only 20 people. But we were walking along a way over there, and one of the people said, what is this grass here? It smells lovely. And I said, oh, we call it karitu in Maori, or holy grass, or sweet grass. And they said, sweet grass. And they just read this book, you see, because the genus that sweet grass belongs to is all worldwide. And we've got one here, we've got several species here, but this one on Banks Peninsula. And it was so important to the original inhabitants, the Maori people on Banks Peninsula, that there's about four place names about Banks Peninsula named after this grass. So you think, why would they name something after grass? And in fact, it was quite important because it was their floor covering, and it was lovely, like sweet smelling, more than a hay smell. It's a very nice sort of, or something, some compound that it's got in it that makes it very nice. And so all over the world, indigenous people have used other species of sweet grass with all their own names for it, of course. So then they said, oh, you might like to look at this book. So that's how, but that's what I'm trying to say is if I read a good book, I'll talk about it to people. Yeah, and when my dad, his minister friends would say, oh, Mac, I never have time to read. And he'd say, so-and-so, you don't have time not to read. And that's good, but I, unfortunately, that bottom shelf there are books that I really want to read that are waiting to be read. So I never, ever find enough time to read. Yeah. As much as I'd like.
Would it be problematical for you if we sent you a couple of books to put on your shelf?
No, it wouldn't be problematical at all.
We have these Centauk, Titan Yoga for them.
You know, I love reading that. You know, reading is good to recommend to people, isn't it? Although some people just aren't readers, are they?
We try to make it, you know, people went to school where they learned to hate reading. And it's such a sad thing. And so I try to do everything I can to empower people to read and write.
Yeah. And why, you see, I find that, well, I hear I'm going to sound like a fanatic again. Handwriting. People are losing the ability to handwrite because they think they can. They learned it at school. But a thing like handwriting is like music or speaking or anything. You have to just constantly exercise those muscles of your body or your brain or whatever. And if you're not doing it every day, you lose it.
Mm.
I find that a tragedy.
Yeah.
So instead of, instead of writing it down in a notebook, just a pencil and a notebook, what does that cost? A few cents. No, they need a computer to do that. They need an iPad or whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
It costs thousands, and I don't know what it costs money.
Mm-hmm.
And it costs the earth, because there's rare metals and there's energy. You know, this Bitcoin nonsense, there's a correspondence at the moment with someone in Australia who reckons that Bitcoin will be the resource for conservation, and they call it global climate dollar or something.
Mm-hmm.
And they actually used us as if we were supporting it. So I had to write to them and say, look, when you phoned me, I made it quite clear that I didn't want anything to do with it, even if only for the fact that even to have Bitcoin, there's all this blockchain stuff that is huge, energy.
Yeah.
And now I've just got another letter back from him explaining why it's good and everything, and apologising. It was a nice letter, apologising for using our name in vain, but